Thanks a lot. Great pleasure to be here. Let me start actually with a picture that I often show, and it's very simple. I call it our business model, and actually it's a straight line, so it's fairly easy to understand what it is. This is the CPU power or throughput capacity that we have either in the top 500 supercomputers or in general in our computing facilities. And much of what I'll be showing today is really thinking as we go along this curve how to deal in a meaningful way with all this computing capacity. Of course, you know that these days one of the leitmotiv in our field is materials design and discovery. Say there is a great enthusiasm, and as everything that happens in science, the big question is to which area do we belong? Is this a collective hysteria, like, you know, it happens all the time in many fields? Is a self-referential niche where a number of people, you know, talk to each other about the importance of what they are doing, or there is genuine innovation? And honestly, I don't know. I hope it's in between here, and I'll show you an example that has been for us our sort of first effort in this field, and it's about discovering novel layered materials or novel two-dimensional materials. Why did we choose this? We did some machine learning. We went to the Nobel Foundation and asked, what do I have to do to get a Nobel Prize? And the answer was, you know, low dimensions, basically. Physics and chemistry in low dimensions, you know, have had a lot of impact. So after having identified the field, let's say, you know, how do we produce two-dimensional materials? Well, a la Geim and Novoselov. I mean, you know, after all, they took scotch tape and they separated a layer of graphene from graphite. These days, there are many ways to do it. The group of Valeria Nicolosi does liquid exfoliation very successfully. You can do now electrochemical intercalation for very fragile materials, or you can just grow it. So we want to replicate this with a computational protocol. And so what did we do? We looked at databases of experimentally known compounds. So we start from something that has been recorded and has been described, and most of the time has been described correctly. And then we try to figure out if that compound looks somehow layered. And if it looks layered, we characterize in full the three-dimensional parent and the possible two-dimensional child. And once we have done that, we characterize all the mechanical, electronic, magnetic properties of the two-dimensional material, and then we see if there is something interesting. And this is a very common protocol in high throughput calculations, and even in the particular field of two-dimensional materials, was first done by Olle Eriksson and Risto Nieminen, this Physical Review X. Richard Henning in Florida has been leading similar studies, Evan Reed in Stanford, and so on and so forth. So let's say nothing new under the sun. So in all of this, though, there is this fundamental concept that we want to be able to go reliably from input to output. And this is an example in which, say, we could ingest a structure from one of these experimental databases, and we want to calculate the property, and we want this to be done automatically without any human intervention, and not only automatically, but in a reproducible way and in a way where we can store all the results for further analysis, for further data mining, for further machine learning. So actually, to do this in a, say, systematic way required really the development of what I call an operating system for computational material science. This is an effort that we started with Boris Kozinski when he was at Bosch. Now he's a professor in Harvard, and especially Giovanni Pizzi and an entire team of developers in Lausanne are pushing the development of this open source Python infrastructure that we call AIDA, that tries to really cover what I consider all the key pillars in this field. That is, the capability to remove from the user the need to follow up all the calculation, These are what we call the low-level pillars of automation and data, where the operating system takes care of the management of thousands of calculations every day on heterogeneous computing resources with asynchronous programming, and couples those calculations to the database by automatically storing, so without the possibility of, say, human error, all the results in a database that is the appropriate structure for computational science and that preserves the provenance. So we want to remove this from the users and have the users focus on this green pillar, this high-level workspace, where they build workflows that are a little bit Lego bricks. You start building a workflow that has a simple calculation and more complex calculations that then you might want to share, and especially you might want to share all your data through pipelines to open repositories with standards that one needs to develop. So I won't really describe AIDA. There is plenty of material on the web, tutorials, videos, virtual machines where you can download it. But let me just give you the image that all this infrastructure sits either on your workstation, in your group. It can sit in a supercomputing center, and you interact with the resources by actually preparing your calculation here. And once the daemon checks that all your calculations are appropriate, it's in charge of submitting, monitoring them, and retrieving. And the entire architecture has been built to be agnostic to everything. It's agnostic to the code that you use, to the property that you calculate, to other mechanisms like the transport to the remote resources. Even the back-end databases can be swapped. And maybe if there is one image that I want to leave you with is the structure of the database. Well, the results of your workflow are stored as a directed acyclic graph. So what you have is that everything that has been calculated in the course of a simple or complex workflow is stored with arrows that really relate and link the parents with the children. So I call it a postmodern relation, because a child can have many parents, and you can traverse the graphs and ask complex queries. So this is a sort of simple example, but this is a more interesting example from the exfoliation project, in which exactly we ingest a material, in this case is this vanadium oxide bromide, and we do all the calculations that we need to do, and they are all stored. So say we look at the primitive cell, we check all the position, all the symmetries. From that, we prepare an input, in this case for a quantum espresso calculation. We relax the three-dimensional structures. We find, say, if it could be two-dimensional. If it is two-dimensional, we start doing all the calculations, including, say, figuring out if it's metallic, that is simple, or if it's magnetic, that is much more complex, if it's ferromagnetic, antiferromagnetic, ferrimagnetic, supercell calculations. At the end, when we have found the electronic structure, we calculate the phonon, is it mechanically stable, and then basically we get to the end result. And this was just for one system, sorry to repeat this. And we do this systematically, so we can figure out all the materials, if they are exfoliable, what properties they are, and then we can examine this band structure and phonon dispersions. It's very relaxing, actually, to spend the time looking at this. Occasionally, we do some science. This was a cute example done by Thibaut Soyer, Marco Gibertini, trying to understand, actually, phonon dispersions in two-dimensional material. And one interesting piece of physics that emerges is that polar materials in two dimensions are not able to support the TOLO splitting that you have for optical phonons in three dimensions. Basically, the longitudinal optical mode doesn't cost more energy than the transverse optic because you don't really have to fill up a three-dimensional crystal with an electric field density. And so what was a splitting in the frequencies in two dimensions becomes a splitting in the slopes. So all of this is stored in its raw form, but it's also stored in a, say, human-readable form that makes for great and bulky supplemental materials, but then becomes useful for anyone that wants to go and browse this data. In this, let me actually sort of reiterate, since we are talking about big data, something that Gabor has mentioned yesterday, and that was very enlightening to us. This comes actually from a different project of creating this Gaussian approximation potential for ferromagnetic iron, where we generate probably 100,000 atomic environments ab initio. And originally, we did this all very carefully and with what everyone would consider, say, a very careful sampling, even for a metal like iron. Well, what it turns out is that because all these calculations that needs to feed a machine learning model, and the calculation are in principle done with different supercells, if you want the energy functional, is slightly different from calculations to calculation because we don't have absolute k-point sampling. And so we really needed to go to this limit of absolute k-point sampling to actually be able to reproduce correctly, say, DFT results like the thermal expansion. And so that's what I think convinced me that highly curated data is really what is needed for machine learning. One of the challenges that we have happily solved in the past year is actually the ability to really run these thousands of calculations every day. This is an example in which we did 35,000 SCF calculations in 2 weeks in November in Pittsdaint, and that really required rewriting the AIDA workflow engine with synchronous programming to be able to have all this individual calculation be continuously tracked and monitored and stored. So in addition to AIDA, I think there is a huge effort that is done in collaboration with the Supercomputing Center to really rearrange the structure of services that are provided by supercomputing centers. We call this infrastructure as a service, and this is, say, what we do typically at CSCS, that's the Swiss Supercomputing Center, but we are starting to mirror our services at Cineca, and as part of the Max Center of Excellence that I'll mention later, we are doing this with more supercomputing center. And so the idea is that it's not that we need any more just CPU, but we need file storage, and in particular, long-term storage, and we need the database services. And all that these services need to be integrated with a structure that, in this case, for us, is really the AIDA infrastructure. And so, say, if you are a computational scientist, like everyone in this room, you really work with the left side of this. But this same infrastructure can actually be used to disseminate and document all your calculation and share them with the community at large. So as part of this effort, we have constructed a dissemination platform that we call Materials Cloud. You can go there, it's open source, where we provide, say, educational material. We provide tools. Some of the work that Michele Ceriotti showed yesterday on machine learning, say, chemical shifts, or machine learning polarizabilities are available there. And in particular, we focus also on offering services like archival services for curated data sets that you can freely upload exactly as you do in the, say, archive preprint server. And if your data sets happens to have been constructed with AIDA, then it makes it very easy also to provide the raw data and the curated data. And so we are working at all this infrastructure. Now, if I go back instead to the science, we were left with this idea that we wanted to look at materials databases and figure out if our inorganic materials were really three-dimensional or they looked layered. Like in this case, you see what we have is that a material is layered in a dimension that is somehow unexpected. It sort of spans a different unit cell. It's interpenetrating. There are zero-dimensional manifold in between. And so what we do is we construct first a connectivity between all the atoms using, say, van der Waals radii, and then we analyze the dimensionality of this. And if something looks promising, we do all the calculations that we need. Now, density functional theory for most of this material is good, and in particular, say, van der Waals density functional theory, we think it does a good job at reproducing the binding energy of this material. These are 40 materials that have been studied with RPA by Thomas Bjorkman, and the results here in blue, I would say, compare fairly well with either the Langret Lundquist functionals or the revised Vidrov Van Voris functional. So with this, this is our pipeline. We analyzed 500,000 structure, of which really after we cleaned up structures that had only, say, partial informations or partial occupancies of atoms, we had, say, stoichiometric compounds that were 186,000. We used two databases, the free code database and the proprietary ICSD. And after looking at which structures were unique, we had 108,000 candidates, 5,600 look layered, and we did all the calculations that I discussed before that are summarized here in this, say, two-dimensional table. These are the descriptors that we use to figure out if our materials are layered and exfoliable or not. On the y-axis, in a semi-logarithmic scale, we have the binding energies, very trivial. And these other descriptors seem to work very well. That is, what we put here in the x-axis is the change in interlayer distance in the three-dimensional parent when we switch on and off the van der Waals interactions. So by removing the van der Waals interaction and monitoring if there is a change in the interlayer distance, we figure out if this van der Waals interaction are important or not. And the clustering of the data is very simple, basically. You see right away that we have more or less three different regions. We have materials that have very large binding energies, and we call those non-exfoliable. Materials that have very low binding energies and dominated by the van der Waals interactions, and we call them easily exfoliable. And then we have this green in between of materials that we think could be exfoliated, and now we start to have experience of exfoliating materials there, and that we call potential exfoliable. So overall, a portfolio of 1,800 materials that could be explored. And what is very reassuring is we recover everything that is known. That is, we find graphene, we find boron nitride, we find black phosphorus, we find transition metal decalcogenides, and so on and so forth. So now this is our, say, curated data set, and is also our playground. And the idea is, well, let's look at it and see if we find something interesting. So first thing that we do is we classify it. And actually, surprisingly, you know, it's not the class of, say, transition metal decalcogenides that is most represented. There are many classes of materials. There are materials that have never been considered like rare earth chalcogenides. And the question here is which properties we should be looking at. Well, something that one starts doing right away is band structures, looking at effective masses for holes and electrons. Those are very relevant for short channel FETs, where you're not really mobility limited, but what you want is the right effective mass, very asymmetric. And so we collaborate with Mathieu Lhuissier, that is an electrical engineer device simulator, to look at IV characteristics of some of these materials, with the goal that one wants to outperform a transition metal decalcogenides by a factor of 5 or 10. One of our specialties, transport and mobilities instead, where we calculate electron-phonon interactions all over the Brillouin zone, and then we use this to solve a Boltzmann transport equation. This was a nice example done together with Cholwan Park, some of it also with Thibaut Soyer and Francesco Mauri and Matteo Calandra, of something that I really call multi-scale and multi-physics, because what we are doing here is calculating band structures with GW, electron-phonon interactions, lifetimes, putting all of that in the Boltzmann equation, and solving it. And you see the results are, as by now we know, we have seen examples of these electron-phonon calculations in the talk of Tomeo Montserrat, Chris Van de Valle. You see as a function of temperature and doping, the theoretical resistivity and the experimental resistivity look reassuringly comparable. And so we have started to do this systematically. Now, these are very expensive calculations, and so Thibaut has developed all the technologies to go and figure out together with Marco Gibertini the different valleys, the different pockets as a function of doping, and do all the extensive integrations that are needed, just restricting it to that pocket in actually in a fat geometry, so with open boundary conditions and using electrostatic doping. And in doing this, one learns actually something. And this is an example that was our first validation before the high throughput, in which we looked at different materials going up to black phosphorus. And you see these are the theoretical mobility increasing. And if you actually look at the valleys around the Fermi energy, what you discover is that you decrease the number of valleys and they become a more anisotropic, because really what limits mobility is intervalley scattering. So we have already, again, in the quest for descriptor, something very simple but very powerful that is really looking at the number, at the shape of the valley, their position, and how to engineer this. Again, it's a little bit like being in a candy store. There are so many properties. This is an example in which we looked at magnetic materials, either magnetic insulator, magnetic metals, half semiconductors, materials that have, say, a large gap on one spin channel and are semiconducting the other spin channel, materials that have flat bands, could be very interesting for, say, a single band Hubbard model, for transparent conductors, because obviously the interband dispersions are very small, and so similar for plasmonic applications, something that we do with Christian Thusen. We have done all these phonons, so all of a sudden we can, you know, look at this phonon dispersion. We find a number of materials that could have charge density waves, both in the 2D and some of these in the 3D parent. And maybe the thing that we've sort of studied first and more extensively with Antimo Marrazzo and Marco Gibertini was the topological character. We removed all the rare earths and we studied the materials by tracking the Vanier centers according to the recipe of David and Alexei. And we found a number of materials that were a quantum spin-only insulator. And actually, so the most promising of all of this was this one here, with a 0.15, 0.16 electron volt band gap in density functional theory. And this is a material that was discovered in 2008, actually close to Minas Gerais in the iron mines there. It was a Czech expedition. They call it Jakutingate. They published the results on a crystallographic journal. The results were imported in these crystallographic databases, and so it came into our database, and we did the calculations in this. Now, the beauty of Jakutingite is that it's really, you know, a topological equivalent of graphene. That is, if you look at the monolayer, it's actually an hexagonal pattern of mercury atoms. And if you look at the band structure, well, if you were to do a standard EFT calculation, you would find a Dirac cone at the Fermi energy. If you actually switch on spin orbit coupling that comes both from the mercury and the platinum, this is mercury platinum selenide, you actually see that is an insulator. And if you study a ribbon, and this is actually doing the full Monty of GW calculation with spin orbit coupling, you discover that this is a topological insulator with a huge band gap of half an electron volt. But the story doesn't end here. What I think is quite remarkable about this, this material is that this is the first example of a material where the topological character is driven by the famous and celebrated Kane-Mealy model. And for this, I just want to show you, the band structure of the insulator calculated here at the DFT level with spin orbit coupling. And you see what I can do now is vanierize the system, and I can calculate the band structure just with a first nearest neighbor Vanier model. And you see I get a Dirac cone. And it's only when I introduce the second nearest neighbor interaction, exactly what is in the Kane-Mealy model, that I open up a gap and I get this blue band that really reproduces quite closely the green band that, of course, I can reproduce perfectly using all the long-term interactions. So this two when a function centered on the mercury do this blue-green job, and it's really this term here that opens the gap, and the standard second nearest neighbors and the in-plane SOC don't really matter. So experimentalists are very enthusiastic. We have been able to exfoliate the sample, to grow the sample, starting to do transport measurements in by now still multi-layers, but also I would say the ARPES characterization looks quite promising. This is Felix Baumberg and the Diamond facility when we compare it with the calculation. So let me conclude. We say there is plenty of room at the top. If we exfoliate, we actually made the cover of Nature Nanotechnology thanks to the blender skills of Giovanni Pizzi, and we are looking at all these properties in this case. So, is it collective hysteria? Is it genuine innovation? Something in between? I don't know yet. I mean, the material space is very vast, but all the interesting things have been probably found. So we are sort of looking for the little gems. Let me conclude thanking the team. This particular work was led by Nicola Munet, but also with Marco Gibertini, Davide Campo, Antimo Marrazzi, Giovanni Cepellotti, and Giovanni Pizzi. There is now a very strong group working on this infrastructure. We are actually looking for seven new postdocs or PhD or software engineers. We'll post this very soon. I call this our open science platform, of course, built on open source code starting from Quantum Espresso, but with all this AIDA and Materials Cloud infrastructure, funded especially by Marvel and Max. And so, conclusions. So, I think I'm optimistic about this field. I think it's genuinely going in the right direction. But I think what it mostly needs is the capability of generating data on demand wherever they are needed with this sort of workflows. And in particular, sort of, you know, accumulating curated data that can be used for machine learning. Thanks a lot for your attention.